You're standing right now with 9 delegates from 100 gangs. And there's over 100 more. That's 20,000 hardcore members. 40,000 counting affiliates. And 20,000 more not organized, but ready to fight. 60,000 soldiers. Now there ain't but 20,000 police in the whole town. Can you dig it? Can you dig it? Can you dig it?
It's the end of the world as we know it. I feel fine.
Good morning, slaves, and welcome to another edition of It's the End of the World as We Know It, and I Feel Fine, the show where the Kool-Aid is not spiked. I am your host, the Stimulator, and right about now, I'd like to rewind to February of this year.
Wait, but what did you say? You're predicting $4 a gallon gasoline?
A number of analysts are predicting $4 a gallon gasoline this spring when they reformulate.
That's interesting. I hadn't heard that.
If you've been to the gas pump lately, you know that dumb motherfucker lied to you again. But we're not surprised. U.S. citizens in major metro areas have reported gasoline rationing, and many have been switching to public transport.
Hi, does this bus go to Pico in Vermont?
Nope.
Cycling, and even walking their fat asses around. Who knows, this oil crisis might be good for the fattest country on earth, but $4 may seem like a bargain for Europeans, who have been paying up to $8 a gallon. Spanish truckers have been blockading roads in protest to the high fuel prices, and farmers in the same country rioted against the police. Fuel riots have also been reported in Hong Kong, Indonesia, India, Portugal, France, and the UK. Now, let's come back home to see how our compatriots are handling the situation.
We want your soul.
You guessed it. To quote Boots Riley, the American sheeple have been told to relax as they ease it in. The good little flock of consumers continue to supply Exxon and Shell with record profits and keep hoping that a change in the White House will make everything nice like the Brady Bunch. Fat chance. I ask you, America, what is the threshold in which you will say enough is enough? I'll tell you. Around late August. When the gallon of gas will be $5. When the electric grid crashes on the hottest day of the year. When millions of you get kicked out of your foreclosed home by the sheriff. When your wife gets laid off her job. When all you can afford to eat is mac and cheese. When you finally fucking realize that the wool has been pulled over your eyes. And that everything you've been told is a motherfucking lie. That your time, your life, your dreams belong to you and not to your boss, your church, or your so-called government. When you do the math and figure out that if millions of us gather,
can you dig it?
We can take this motherfucker head on, slay the beast that enslaves us, and get on with building a world that we can be fucking proud of.
Can you dig it?
Now back to the apocalypse.
We are about less than 2 months from the Republican convention, and since I know that many of you who are planning to attend are newbies, I figure it's a good time to introduce a new section to this motherfucking show. These are your motherfucking rights. I spoke with Carla Magnuson, a lawyer with the National Lawyers Guild, and one of the many legal ninjas who will be making sure that the Popo don't get out of hand. Hey, counsel, How the fuck are you?
I'm okay, given the fact that in a little over 2 months, we are here in the cities, are going to be invaded by the Republican National Convention.
Carla, is it illegal to protest the conventions? Hey, suckers, don't forget that subMedia is having its summer pledge drive in order to fund this show. If you got the George W. payoff in the mail, consider throwing some cash our way. In return, I'll send you some goodies. Just visit my fucking website, stimulator.tv, and click on the Stimulator Stimulating Stimulus Package.
Technically, it's not illegal to protest. We still have a First Amendment that gives you the right to free speech. What the government can do is limit your time, space, and manner of how you go about exercising your free speech. So if the city of St. Paul says you can have free speech up until this cross-section, but past this cross-section, no more free speech, then they can keep you from protesting past that cross-section. So what we're trying to do with the National Lawyers Guild is to keep as much access for free speech as we can possibly manage, given the fact that the city does have the ability to put constraints on your abilities to have free speech. So they keep saying that all of St. Paul is a free speech zone. We'll see how that works out.
Okay, let me give you a hypothetical situation. Let's say I decide to come.
Mm-hmm.
No, not that way. Jeez, I mean, come to the convention. And I am holding a sign with an intelligent slogan such as, Bush, eat shit. And a cop calls me over. What the fuck do I do?
Here in Minnesota, we have what we call Minnesota Nice.
Okay, are you sure?
And the natural response to that, or the socialized response to that, is to make polite conversation, to not be rude, because we don't like to be rude here.
Ma'am, I answered your question. I answered the darn... I'm cooperating here.
In Know Your Rights training, we basically say any conversation you have with a law enforcement officer gives them... It's sort of the equivalent of inviting a vampire into your house. You give them power when you start having conversation with them, even if it's the most casual of conversation. So what we recommend, you're free to do whatever you want to do, but what we recommend is to either ignore them or say, no, I don't want to talk to you, or ask the question, excuse me, officer, am I being detained? And they can either say no or yes. And sometimes they'll say no, but make you stand there and talk to them. At that point, whether or not they say you're being detained, you're being detained. And we say, stop talking, I'm going to invoke my rights, I'm going to not talk, and I'd like to talk to a lawyer. At that point, they can either arrest you, and they should tell you why you're being arrested. And once you're arrested, you can either give them your identification information or not. If you give it to them, you're more likely to get processed through the system. There's something called jail solidarity, in which you just make it difficult for the system to work. So you muck up the system, you don't give them any information, they throw you in jail or we don't even know where they're going to put the people that are being detained. Could be a big field in a suburb outside of St. Paul. It's still up in the air.
Let's say Officer Friendly is super Minnesota nice, as you say, and tells me that if I just answer a few questions, he'll let me go.
Even if you're very smart, even if you're very savvy, even if you think you've done absolutely nothing wrong, we say, just don't go there.
And that about does it for this edition of It's the End of the World Is United and I Feel Fine. To find out more about your motherfucking rights, visit nlg.org. I'd like to thank all the peeps who made my Midwest tour a success. Carla, Gina, John, Anne, The Hideout, Confess, Oscar, Tanya, Tonka, Wendy, David, Gus, Brian, Eric, Amanda, and most especially Rob T. You guys are motherfucking ninjas. For more links galore on anti-convention actions, visit my fucking website, stimulator.tv. and I'm gone like a dollar in a crack den.
Remember, kids, you can podcast high-quality video of this show at submedia.tv.
There's something else that is said after a death. This one happens after the funeral, after the burial, back at the house. Sooner or later, someone is bound to say the following, especially after a few drinks. You know, I think he's up there now, smiling down at us. And I think he's pleased.